Welcome again to Global Conference TV. This is my book story. Today I meet a young man who's doing marvelous work around South Africa. His name is Howard Zondo. He's a radio personality, he's an author of 2 books, he's running an organization, and he's doing a marvelous work around his country. There's something that touched me when he first writes the first book. He's like young, black, and powerful. In my mind, he said, what is wrong with this young man? How can you write a book young, black, and powerful? But when you read the book, you understand his heart. And another book that is trending right now, Lesson from a Domestic Worker. So today we are with Howard Zondo, and he's going to share with us a powerful motivation. He's one of the greatest motivational speakers that I know, and I know he's still going to do great work around the world. I always told him that one day he'll be president, and he's refusing, but I know this will be on YouTube 20 years from today, and he will give me a call. Mr. Howard, yes, welcome sir. To the show, man.
I'm happy to be here, sir.
It's a pleasure, man, to meet with you. You know, I've been following your work, and I must say you are doing amazing work, man. At your age, what you are doing, you know, men twice your age, they want to do what you are doing, but they are not doing it.
Yes.
So tell us, where did it all begin?
Yeah, I think, to be honest, everything that I've done personally has been one way or the other influenced by God, to be honest.
Wow.
I think that's where everything started, because with me, the first book, Young, Black and Powerful, it was merely me expressing myself and my thoughts as a young black person who suffered from low self-esteem.
Okay.
Because I used to think that if you are dark in complexion, then that means you're not handsome, obviously, because I'm a guy. And also, this is coming from a very funny perspective, because, you know, as the gents, when you guys are playing, sometimes you just love to tease each other. So I was always called Darky, Umnyamad, you know. And then when you start to grow, you start to realize, wait, actually, agyoni joke with this thing. I'm actually very dark in complexion. So that's when now I started to somehow build that self-hatred. So when I was writing the book, because it was during December holidays in 2015, I was doing my grade 10 at the time. And so during those holidays, I was doing public speaking. So when you do public speaking, you prepare speeches.
Yeah.
So that's where literally the book came about. So it was just the pen and paper I was writing and writing. And then my mentor, who was my teacher at the time, Mr. Thulani Mphahlele, I gave him the book. I said, this is what I was doing during my holidays. Then from then, I went through the self-publishing route, and so Young, Black and Powerful was pretty much affirming myself. Little did I know that it's going to inspire so many young black people, even the older people, to understand that, you know what, yes, you are young, you are black, but at the very same time, you're powerful. So that's literally where everything started for me.
Okay, for now, I understand that you are flowing in your gifts, in your dream. You do amazing, but what is your dream, man?
Honestly, my dream personally would be to become everything that I've always hoped to become, which is to become an author, but not just an author, which I am right now.
Okay.
But my dream is rather different, because it's not my personal dream.
Okay.
It's rather a dream that I have for everyone, because I want to see people changing their own struggles, changing their pain, changing their difficulties into something that can motivate them, because that's what led me to be who I am today. So my dream is literally to see people becoming inspired by their problems, not actually becoming demotivated by their problems, because the secret onus in life lies in those problems. It's about how you handle those problems. So my biggest dream is really to, you know, motivate people with my message.
Okay.
And just to see everyone succeeding in whatever they're good at. So yeah.
And I read in your book there's a part where you say I have a dream. Howard the Dreamer.
Yes,
can you share with my viewers a snip of that?
Yeah.
That part of the dream, that part of the passage on the book.
My dream is that one day my books will be distributed throughout the whole world, just like alcohol is distributed. And also my biggest dream is to see young people not having too many homework so that they can work on their gift. And my dream is also to see young talentpreneurs actually breaking the systems of Egypt, which are telling us to get jobs, get employed, but rather to start working on our own dreams. And above it all, my biggest dream is to see everyone literally becoming inspired by information as much as we are with entertainment. So that is a dream that I'm hoping to fulfill and actually fill up my own events that will inspire many people, just like taverns and shebeens do. So yeah, that is what I have a dream about.
Well, man, that's a powerful and a big dream for a young man, and I hope that you will be one of the first guys who will fill up the dome, fill up stadiums, and because it's possible. Like if you're looking guys like Tony Robbins,
yes,
he's doing it every year.
Yeah.
There's a guy who Grant Cardone, he's doing it every year. So yeah, it's possible, and we need young people like you who will stand up and say, this is what I want to do, and they're going.
Yes,
there's something that when I was checking your book, The Lesson from a Domestic Worker, you spoke about information transformation and application. Is it application or implementation? And it's a challenge that you see on social media. People say, my goal this year is to read 100 books. And when you check before and the after, it's still the same. And when I was reading on your book, you say there's a difference between acquiring information and applying it. Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah. So the emphasis was basically on the fact that you can read 1,000 books within a year and still walk out a fool, because that knowledge is not applicable to you. In a sense that, say for example, it's an easy example, you know, say for example I pour water in a glass. Chances are the information was, I'm thirsty, so what do I need? I need water. Where do I put the water? In a glass. So that's where I literally have the knowledge and also the implementation. So the problem now is that you are thirsty, but then you're going to grab food, which is not applicable to your situation. You don't need food at the time. The only thing you need is water. So what I'm trying to say is that also it's not the information that we lack, it's also the lacking of interest in the information that we should acquire. Just like for instance, if you are, for example, say you're an author and you want to write Christian books, would honestly non-fiction books be relevant to what you want to do? No. Hence you'd never find a doctor studying law, because it's not applicable to him. So hence I'm saying that it's not, the problem is not with the information, it's what you,
the relevance of the information,
exactly, and also what you do with it. It's like, for example, if you have 100,000 in your bank account and you wanted to buy a car, yes, you have the money, but until you go to the garage, you'll never have the car. So it same applies that you can have 1,000 book piled up, or you can even have 1,000 degrees piled up, but until you know how to do or what to do with whatever that you've acquired, chances are you're just gonna remain the very same person. So it's more about that, what I have, is it really relevant? And if it is relevant, can I also use it? So it's pretty much in that aspect.
And that's an interesting point, because you find many Africans, they are qualified.
Yeah.
Like there are guys who have PhDs, there are guys who have 10 degrees. And there was one client of mine, and I was doing a consultation with him. And then he told me, dude, I have 10 degrees. And for me, I was like, man, you have 10 degrees and then you have not have been taught about selling, because the guy is an author and he's not selling his books. And for me, I said, what were they teaching you in those 10 degrees? Because it's just confirming what you are saying, that you have information, but it's not applicable to you. So that guy with those 10 degrees, he needed one course for one day that will teach him how to sell. So what you are saying, man, it's... It's powerful.
Yes.
And there's something that, like, when I was reading your book, I was like, I laughed. But okay, this dude, he said, my greatest passion is soccer. And
yes,
and for me, and I was like, wow, this is amazing. And you shared that you had to retire early.
Yes.
And was it because you want to pursue your dream or what? Yeah.
Right. So yeah. So Mina, my biggest passion has always been to play football. I was and I still am a good striker. You know, plus Bafana is lacking strikers up there. But yeah, so this is what I always tell people. Mina, personally, it was never my dream to become an author, to become a speaker. All these things chose me.
Okay.
When I was found in that trapped box of under self-esteem. So personally, my biggest dream, I've always been inspired by Cristiano Ronaldo. I believe everyone knows him. So Mina, personally, I thought I was going to become a professional football player because during my primary years, I was excelling in primary in football. And in 2012, when I was doing my grade 7, I was called for trials by Mamelodi Sundowns, which was in Mamelodi in my township. Then I excelled with the trials as well. So during the following year, in 2013, I continued to play at Mamelodi Sundowns. 2014, I was supposed to go to the academy. So within that short period of time, it actually happened that I lost interest in playing football. Literally because somehow things changed. There was a new coach, so the new coach that came in somehow just didn't like me. So I was practicing enough but never got to play any match.
Okay.
So I also got upset. Then that's where I spoke to my mom, and then she said,